Hello, everyone, and thank you all for attending today. My name is Nicole Jarvis, and I'm the Senior Manager of Programs at Cancer and Careers, and I will be your host for today's webinar. Before we begin, a few housekeeping items related to accreditation. And for those of you who don't require this information, please bear with us. I promise I'll be as fast as possible. Today's webinar is accredited for CEUs by NASW, the New York State Education Department's Board for Social Work, American Nurses Credentialing Center, and the California Board of Registered Nursing, as well as the Society for Human Resource Management. If you plan on receiving continuing education credit for this program from any of these accrediting bodies, please proceed with the following steps. First, you must log in individually. Participants who listen in on someone else's line will not receive credit. Second, you must complete and submit the evaluation and post-test, as well as receive a passing grade on the post-test. Following today's session, you'll receive an email with all of this information. This email will come at 5 p.m. Eastern time on Thursday, and certificates will be emailed within 4 to 6 weeks. Also, please note that the planners and presenters for this program have not disclosed any pertinent financial relationships or conflicts of interest, and that no commercial support has been provided for this program. The Balancing Work and Cancer webinar series is sponsored in part by a generous grant from Genentech. Additionally, we just want to highlight our year-round sponsors that support all of CAC's core content, including this one. So for many, stress in the workplace is to be expected. Factoring balancing a cancer diagnosis, treatment, and recovery with work can make these stresses often feel overwhelming. That's why learning techniques for caring for yourself during these high stress times is a vital skill to develop. We're thrilled to be able to provide a session of the Balancing Cancer and Work webinars focusing on this critical topic. In the next 60 minutes, we'll help you to rethink your priorities and explore strategies and techniques for the balancing act that comes between work and cancer so that stress doesn't get the best of you, your productivity, and mental and physical wellness. We'll have a question and answer period at the end of the webinar. All questions that you want to be answered should be entered into the Q&A box located on the top or the bottom of your screen. Please do not ask questions in the chat box. For those of you who are joining us via the phone today, you can press *9, which will alert us of your question and we can call on you. So to take us through this topic, I'm thrilled to introduce Julie Larson. Julie Larson is a psychotherapist working primarily with people under the age of 40 around issues of wellness, loss, and life transitions. Prior to establishing her private practice, Julie was the young adult program director at Cancer Care. In addition to her private practice, Julie frequently presents to both survivor and professional audiences on a range of topics focusing on the impact of a cancer diagnosis. She presented for Cancer and Careers for many years, and we're lucky that she continues to share her knowledge and her expertise. So now I'm happy to turn this floor over to Julie to get things started. Julie?
Thank you, Nicole. I appreciate that. It's always an honor of mine to be here with all of you. And we have a lot to talk about. I'm so glad that Cancer and Career consistently places this topic within their webinar series and as part of their conferences, because going back to work, navigating work during treatment, or deciding how to talk about your cancer, disclose or not to disclose, and manage yourself while you are at work is a big piece of what it's like to have cancer and go through the workplace and be in the workplace. So, thanks for inviting me. Let's get started. So let's see here. I'm gonna see if I can get moving here. There we go. Oh, now there's a bit of a delay. Let me get backwards here. Hold on. There we go. Okay, so today this is kind of an outline of where we're gonna be headed. What triggers my stress? That might be things that you already are aware of, what you know, and also what you will be continue to become aware of over time. How do I recognize it? That might sound like an elementary question, but I think it really bears kind of thinking about, how does stress show up for me? What do I do with it? That's the question of the day. And what do I do with that feeling, or how do I navigate that? And how do I build my personal resilience? Working with a little delay. There we go. Oh, And then it goes twice. Sorry, we'll get this figured out. So stress is your body's way of responding to a demand. We are biologically programmed to feel this feeling of stress. And our body has, if you think about it, when you feel stress, your body has a physical, heart rate, breathing, sweaty, kind of pit in your stomach, emotional, fear, anxiety, worry, doubt, and mental response to stress. There are many different types of stress, and not all stress is bad. Then finally, stress is subjective. So what completely stresses me out might not bother you at all, and vice versa. And in fact, I think of that sometimes, that some of the biggest concerns within relationships are often when our stress isn't fully understood by those that we're working alongside. So when I said stress is not always bad, think about your life and moments when you felt that stress really can motivate us to change behavior and achieve a goal, right? We feel a sense of stress when we need to act quickly or meet a deadline. If you've ever, been on a first date or had to get a project done by a deadline or had to have a really hard conversation, you have likely felt stress. And sometimes that stress helps us to focus. It helps us to rise to the challenge and to become much more attentive. It helps us to kind of tune in or block out distractions so that we can do the task at hand. And when we respond to that type of stress, we think of it as kind of meeting a challenge. On the other hand, distress. So the concept of distress is when we perceive ourselves unable to cope, right? I just can't do this. I'm overwhelmed. I'm confused. I'm lost. I feel fear and doubt. All of those feelings kind of bubble up to the surface when we feel like we're beyond our capacity. And distress tends to leave us depleted of energy, whereas the other stress that I was talking about kind of seems to fuel us and energize us and get us to kind of focus and sit up on our chair. Distress leaves us feeling like no energy, and it feels very unpleasant. So first of all, I just want to qualify those differences, because when you are at work, there may be plenty of times when you feel stress in a very healthy and normative way, because you've got to get something done or you've got to have a big conversation. And we need to begin to conceptualize or think about that, frame that stress in a way that's like, okay, there's a challenge ahead of me. There's a challenge in front of me, and my body is gearing up and getting ready for me to attend to this, as opposed to, ooh, I feel all of that stress in my body and I can't do this and I'm retreating and I'm going to slip back. So sometimes when we feel stress, it takes that kind of mental evaluation of, is this a challenge or is this a threat? That begs the question of, how does stress show up for you? And so as I go through this slide and as I talk right now, what I'm hoping for is that you sit back in your chair or you kind of reflect and think as I'm speaking about yourself and what it's like when you personally feel stress. And what I've noticed in my career is that, yes, while every single person responds to stress in a thinking, feeling, and physical way, we often have a tendency. So I've sat in my private practice for many years, and I know that for some people, and I'm going to call this particular group of people my thinkers, for some people, their stress first shows up for them, or they first recognize it because they have spinning thoughts, right? And they're kind of going through all the different scenarios in their head. There's probably a lot of what ifs, this and what if that, or if this person were to do this or that is going to happen, or maybe fortune telling, all kinds of things, should, must, oughts, assumptions, comparisons, all of those thoughts begin to spin and begin to kind of clutter your thinking. And when you're feeling an intense moment of stress, that's kind of when you can recognize, ooh, I'm feeling that spinning in my head, that thinking is on overdrive. That's a signal to me that I'm feeling stress. And then we can plug in some of the strategies that I'm going to get to later. But thinking is one of the ways in which stress shows up for people. Feeling. So similarly, I sit with people in my office who aren't as tuned into what's racing through their mind, but they feel overwhelm and they feel more emotional. They feel irritable. They feel just frustrated and annoyed. They feel confused or they feel lost, are teary and sad, or maybe really angry, right? So their emotions tend to show up loud. So again, I'm saying that I feel like some people have a tendency for their thoughts to get their attention first, and other people, their emotion gets their attention first. And then finally, there's a kind of a third way that stress shows up for us is in our body. So again, I might be sitting with somebody in my office and they're not really tuned into the thoughts. When I say to them, what are you thinking about or what's driving that? They can't really name what they're thinking. If I ask them how they're feeling, that's tricky for them to kind of nail down and name that feeling. But gosh, they've got a pit in their stomach or they have a headache or they're tense. They can feel tension in their shoulders or their back or they feel a fatigue that doesn't match kind of their sleep, you know, how they're doing. That fatigue is a sign of stress too. So do you know how stress first shows up for you? So I've said it many times already. I will say it one more time, that stress shows up for us in all of these ways. So for all people, it shows up in your thinking, in your feeling, in your body. But how does it show up first for you? And I think that might be a really important thing to kind of consider and reflect on, because it's your first flag. It's your first like little message from your body of like, whoo, slow down. Something big is happening for you. And we've got to take care of this now. So I want you to kind of think about that thinking, feeling, and your body. When we feel a moment of stress, we immediately do, probably without even realizing it, an evaluation. Okay, what are the demands of the situation? And what are the resources I have in order to cope with this? And the way in which you kind of evaluate that is how much stress or how that stress is defined for you is whether like a challenge, like, okay, I've got this. This is going to take some time. It's going to take some attention. It's going to demand something of me, but I think I've got what it takes. Or I can take no more. I'm at my limit. This is too much. I'm teary. And this makes me feel teary. This makes me feel irritable. This makes me feel overwhelmed. I cannot do this. So that evaluation is one of the first things that happens for us when we feel stressed. So, this slide is kind of challenging you or kind of saying that one of the habits that might be a really smart one to begin to cultivate for yourself. And goodness, I've been talking about this my whole career, but I will tell you with increasing emphasis over this past year, as we've all been dealing with stress in many different areas of our life, develop this habit of checking in with yourself. Whether that is when you are seated at a desk at work, whether you're running around at work and busy with whatever it is that your responsibilities are, or whether you're just in your kitchen getting ready to make dinner or throwing your feet over the side of the bed to begin the day. How am I doing? How am I right now? And just kind of taking inventory. Can you name the feeling that you might be feeling? Maybe that feeling is kind of disconnected. Maybe it's feeling lonely. Maybe it's feeling, again, like I said, overwhelmed or uncertain. Maybe it's feeling anxious about a big conversation, worried and misunderstood. So are you able to name what it is that's going on for you? In my practice, I notice, and I can't see you. I wish I could, but I know that so many of the people that I work with, sometimes we have a very small, whether we like it or not, very small feeling vocabulary, right? So the feelings that we have, we use those same feelings again and again and again. So if you can begin to broaden that feeling vocabulary of yours and get really specific about what you're feeling, that's going to help you to figure out how you care for yourself. So gosh, I'm feeling dread. I'm feeling bored. I'm feeling really concerned, right? So there's so many different feelings, and those words that we use help us to kind of color in the spaces and know then how to care for ourselves. That's one of the things I would say in this habit of learning to check in with yourself. Secondly, where am I feeling this in my body? So if you just, that requires you to kind of step back and like listen or pay attention, right? So where are my feelings? Okay, I feel a little rumble in my stomach. I feel kind of a pit there, or I feel tension in my shoulders. You know, where are you feeling this in your body? And what are you doing in that exact right now that is helping you? Okay, I'm seated, I'm breathing, I'm taking a moment to feel calm. Or what are you doing that's not working well for me? Okay, come to find out right now, I'm totally lost in my social media thread, right? And I'm aware that I'm beginning to feel more and more overwhelmed or more and more irritated and agitated because I'm scrolling down this list. That's one of the things that I hear a lot, right? The way in which news is triggering a lot of feelings and emotion for people these days. But there's many experiences. What am I doing that's not working for me? I'm staying in my office, I'm not connecting with other people. I'm feeling really isolated and I'm feeling unsure. And that's keeping me from connecting even more and withdrawing and constricting even more because I'm feeling unsure and doubtful. And I'm not sure that that's working for me. Because once I begin to talk to people and kind of connect with others, ooh, then I get this wonderful perspective and balance and I feel different. So until you begin to pay attention and notice what am I doing that's working for me and what am I doing that's not working well for me, that's part of self-care, is recognizing that. Are you with me that I feel like our world moves really fast, right? We are all balancing and juggling so many things in our lives. And because of that, there's sometimes this experience of just kind of gripping and holding on through all of the things that we have to get through in a day or all of the tasks on a to-do list. And when we feel all of that busyness or when we feel all of those things that we need to do, some of this skill of checking in with ourselves or tuning in and paying attention to how we're doing kind of gets pushed off to the wayside. So I'm using this presentation and I'm challenging you to bring that back up to the surface, just checking in with yourself about how you're doing through the day. So back to that evaluation, when you're stressed, you do a quick mental evaluation. How hard is this going to be? Do I have the skills to manage this? Do I have the emotional strength and courage? And is there anyone that can help me? Now, that the answers to that when we feel overwhelmed could be all in the negative. And so my hope is that as we go through some of the strategies that I'm going to talk about here, we can slow down and begin to round out the answers to those questions by either thinking about past moments in our lives, whether they are at work professionally or they're in personally, where we have done hard things, where you have managed hard conversations or crossed the finish line on a hard project or been able to kind of get through a day that seems in hindsight like unbelievable that you were able to do. Sometimes if we gather on that historical knowledge, that gives us confidence to face the day ahead. Do you have the skills? So cancer certainly challenges us and sometimes illuminates for you and for the first time skills and strengths that you may just be discovering about yourself. So it's really important to kind of grab onto those and begin to recognize, you know what? I never realized before my diagnosis how organized I could be. But I had to be so organized with my doctor's appointments and my contacts and my health insurance and my billing, all of those things, that makes me realize, gosh, as it turns out, I'm a pretty organized person and I can apply that to this skill toward this stress. Or I learned through my cancer diagnosis that I have an incredible frustration tolerance, that things were not rarely in my control and that I couldn't, and I just had to go with it. And so that ability to be flexible, I'm gonna use that. I'm gonna plug that in right now as before I enter into this team meeting and everybody's gonna have a very strong opinion about things. I'm gonna let myself be open to moving in new ways. So sometimes when we think about how our experience has informed us about ourselves, that can lend us confidence to face the task or the day ahead. Emotional strength and courage, goodness, that is something that many people discover within themselves. You know, even that vulnerability, feeling vulnerable requires a certain amount of strength and courage in order to keep moving through. And is there anyone that can help me? So often when we feel overwhelm and stress, all of that sits solely on your plate or on your shoulders. And when you begin to look at this, who else could I reach to ask questions? Is it fair? And maybe that's within my workplace. Maybe that's my team members. Maybe that's a supervisor. Or maybe that's somebody in my personal life that when I begin to talk about this and process this out, that's kind of an organic way of loosening the knots of this problem and beginning to kind of help me find my way through. So who else is available to me? Strategy one. So I'm going to go through four different strategies. It's about thinking about stress. And I'm going to kind of frame them in this way of, is this a thinking strategy? Is this an emotional feeling strategy? Or is this a physical in your body strategy? Okay, so we all have different strengths. And so where you find that and whether you kind of move between all of these different ways of caring for yourself. So strategy one is working in your head. All right, so you feel stress, and immediately your mind is, what if? What if this happens? What if this doesn't happen? What if this person says this? What if I don't get what I need? What if, what if, what if? You know? Immediately in that what if, you've got, I've written here, there probably are more. I'd be curious to hear if you have other people have other answers to their what ifs. But I've written four possible responses to what if that might help to kind of bring evidence to the contrary of that nightmare or that train of terribles that takes off in your mind. So what if, answer that to what is. Instead of what if, can we bring that to what is? That's taking your mind from being very future oriented, where anxiety often lives, anxiety lives in the future, to right now into this moment now. So take inventory of your present, what you know for sure. Because what if is forecasting and it's future telling, right? So can we bring it on back to what is right now, and how you balance your thinking. What if, you can also say, what else? Okay, so if what is feels like it's dismissing or minimizing your worry, own that. Okay, that's a possibility. What else? What could be other possible truths here? Are there more than one path through this dark woods, right? So yes, what you're worrying about, that what if could be possible. Are there more truths? Can you turn the lights on in the rest of the room? Does that make sense? What if, then what? So I've sat with a lot of clients who've told me, you know, Julie, I try that what is. I try to come back to the present and my mind keeps cycling back to the what if. And then I do that what else, and nothing ever seems quite as likely as my worst fear or my worst nightmare. So then I said, well, what if we follow it? What if we just go with it for a moment? If you, and then say, well, what if, well, then what? Then what would you do? And then after that, then what? Then what? Then what? Just keep walking down that path and answering those questions. And what I've found in my office and what my clients have shared with me is that sometimes when their mind is just heels digging in on this worry, that to allow it to kind of fully bloom and just follow it can be settling. That it gives them an opportunity to actually come up with a concrete plan for that worst case scenario. As an example, I have a client who, I'm thinking of a client right now who was very worried. She's a single mother and was very worried about, what if she had to go to the hospital? What if she had to unexpectedly go to the doctor or the hospital at a time when she couldn't get a caregiver? Or, you know, what would she do with her young child? And first of all, that was a worry, right? That wasn't necessarily her present. She was safe. She was healthy. She was okay. So we tried the what if to what is, but that kept coming back. What else? Could there be more truths to kind of what she was feeling, what that concern was be? Wasn't enough. So then what? Well, then what would you do? Well, I guess I would call my neighbor. Okay. And then what would happen? And then what? My neighbor would come over, and then you would, and then, but how would I get there? Okay. And we began to kind of figure out what she would do if that really came to pass. And in doing that, it gave her a plan and a strategy that helped her to kind of just relax into this wasn't happening right now. But if it did, she knew what she was going to do. What if, to what's left? So if that worst case scenario did happen, your boss said this, or the project doesn't get done, or the deadline isn't met, or you fumble through a really difficult conversation with someone, then what's left? So, you know, our lives are very full. And hopefully many of you have many different pieces of your identity. Perhaps part of that is a professional, your work identity. Another part of that is relationships at home, whether that's a spouse or a partner or a mother or a child, a daughter or a son or a sister or a brother. Some of that might be, you know, your sense of faith or a hobby or an interest that you're in. Sometimes when we get really consumed by a worry, that is taking over our sense of who we are. And when we say what's left, it kind of is requiring or forcing us to kind of move over and be flexible with our identity, to kind of shift over into another part of ourselves where we can also feel meaning and fulfillment and reward and our sense of our identity. So does that make sense? So this what else also could mean, if this were to happen, what else do I have available to me? What is the big giant picture of my life? Strategy two. So, and all of those what ifs, those are all kind of in the way that you're thinking, right? The way that you're kind of redirecting and challenging your thoughts. Strategy two is about your feeling and how you're taking in this emotionally. So all of that thought challenging that I just did in the past slide is healthy and effective. All of those types of things are strategies within kind of cognitive behavioral therapy that is proven technique of addressing anxiety and depression that can be as effective as medicine, right? So this is very healthy and very effective. However, let's be honest, your worry voice will always and consistently work to ensnare you into a debate, right? So you can build those muscles of thought challenging, but you're also going to need to build some muscles into how you learn to tolerate and stay in an emotional moment. Because expelling a thought or trying to debate your worry may not work long term. It might buy you some time. It might get you through your day. It might help you to get over a hurdle. But that worry kind of keeps coming. And what I tell my clients is when you hear that yes, but, yes, but, yes, but, well, as a therapist, I'm listening for that yes, but. And as soon as I hear it, as soon as I begin to kind of work with my clients about challenging thoughts, finding evidence to the contrary, and keep getting back to the worry, I know, and I help them to learn to know, it's less about what you're worrying about and more about the fact that you are caught in the worry loop, that you are worrying, the experience of worrying. So then we're like, okay, it no longer is about the fact that I might have had errors on that paper that I just turned in and that I want to check it and look at it again. Or it's no longer about those words that my boss said to me and I'm reassessing it and reevaluating again and again in my head, or what I think other people are thinking about in my office and how they're perceiving me. Now it's not about that content. It's about the fact that this ruminating thinking is getting in my way. What do I do with this spinning thought? Walk away from the fight. So first you got to recognize that you're doing it. That's why I say do all that thought challenging, but when you hear that yes, but, you're in the loop. And now we need to see if that for what it is. We got to walk away from the fight. I say that to my clients and they're like, oh, great, but how am I going to do that? That sounds lovely, Julie, but what does that mean? Well, your fear and your worry may not completely go away, right? It might be unrealistic to think that you're suddenly going to feel calm and you're going to feel quote unquote okay. That fear and that worry might still sit there and be lingering in the background. And I say to people all the time, build this skill of being able to name it and claim it. So that habit I talked about way back about checking in on yourself, this is a chance. How do you check in yourself? What am I feeling? I'm feeling dread. I'm feeling overwhelmed. I'm feeling irritable. I'm feeling fear. Naming the feeling gives you just a bit of distance from being the feeling. So, and before we name the feeling, you are overwhelmed or you are irritable, right? As soon as you name, I am feeling irritable, I am feeling overwhelmed, then you've just given yourself a little space so that you can climb into the driver's seat and make a choice on how you're going to respond and attend to the fact that you are feeling this way in this one moment. Right? Before you name it, that feeling is kind of driving the bus, right? So when we do this and when we begin to name those feelings and recognize that they might be in the background as we work hard to attend to the task at hand or what's right in front of us in this moment, this day, this, you know, this second, that we begin to build a tolerance for living with that uncomfortable feeling. And that gives, when we have a bigger tolerance for allowing uncomfortable feelings to kind of be in the background or be with us, it gives us more flexibility with our attention. Then we are like, okay, I've got that feeling. I feel that buzz of unsettledness with me today. I felt that yesterday too. So I know that I got through yesterday. And so with this feeling of unsettledness, I'm going to just step forward. I'm going to start making my breakfast. I'm going to start getting dressed. I'm going to go to work and I'm going to do the first two things that I need to do. And then I'm going to move to the third. You just begin to slowly have a little bit more flexibility with your attention, despite the fact that that feeling is there. We're not fighting with the feeling. I often talked with people too that coping is this dynamic interplay between calming yourself and understanding insight into why we got upset in the first place, right? And often our society, we're thinkers and we're problem solvers. We want to dive right into why do I feel this way and how can I feel different? And we skipped right over the calming piece. So learning how to calm your body, how to get grounded, how to soften those edges, that's as important of a skill to understanding what are my triggers, why are those my triggers, why does this pattern of behavior continually happen for me? We've got to learn to both calm and have insight. And sometimes when we're feeling particularly stressed, calming's the only thing we need to do, right? I don't know if any of you have had the experience that the more you talk about something or the more you kind of try to understand something, the more upset you get, right? Does that ever happen for you? So sometimes the more we try to understand, the more we kind of are processing and analyzing and looking at something that fuels the feeling. And the step one really is, how do I get calm? And when we feel calm, we not only feel better, but we act smarter. You're going to be able to better understand yourself and better care for yourself. Strategy three, the here and the now. So since we're talking about calming, I think one of the most powerful ways to calm yourself, people are like, okay, I like this idea of calming. That feels good, Julie. Let's talk more about that. I think one of the most powerful ways to calm yourself is to use your body. Okay. So getting yourself back to the here and now, and this can happen when you're at work. This can happen when you're home. This can happen when you're out and about, right? How do you get yourself calm and grounded into your now? Taking your thinking back, taking, you know, your emotions, turning down the volume, use your body. Your five senses are probably the most tangible way to use your body. So I don't know if any of you have heard the technique or the strategy of 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, but 5, 4, 3, I say that to my clients a lot. It's a common strategy of grounding yourself. And can you name five things you can see? Like right now, can I look around the room and I can name five things that I can see? 4, can you name 4 things that you smell are here? Here's a powerful sense. Maybe 4 things that you hear, 3 things that you smell, 2 things that you feel. And when you think about feeling, that is maybe the feel of your sweater on your skin. Maybe it's the temperature in the room or the feel of sun on your skin or the weight of your body on a chair. And then 1 thing that you can taste. Now, I don't know, that's a little trickier, but maybe you might taste, you know, just warmth in your mouth or whatever that is, you know, maybe you put in a piece of gum or something like this. But whatever that is, whatever those things are that you're tuning into your senses, it is requiring, in fact, demanding of you to get very focused on your here and now, your present. Okay. So that's one strategy. I've often talked, I was just in a session last night telling my client that when they feel overwhelmed, put their 2 feet on the ground, rock between their toes and their heels, or put your hands on your thighs or on your arms to give yourself a little hug. All of those things help you to connect to your body. I think there's a book out there. If it's not a book, I've heard a client say it, that when feeling anxiety, he said he lived a distance from his body. Does that resonate? That when you're feeling anxious or any kind of big feeling, that we're living kind of in our head or in our emotions, a bit of a distance from our body. And so reconnecting to your body and feeling grounded again helps you to feel back into your here and now. Break your time into manageable chunks. So if that feeling is too big, I'm working with someone right now who's just newly diagnosed and still waiting for information about the diagnosis itself, about, the treatment plan, that very difficult place of newly diagnosed and learning all of that. That's hard to do. And she's going to work, and not a lot of people at work know at this point, because there's not a lot to know. So it's very hard to manage all of that uncertainty and stay attentive and on point at work. So we talk a lot about managing your time. Just break it down. Let's just do this task. Let's get to lunch. That's it. And then at lunch, then we're just going to focus then the afternoon. And then we're going to focus on the after work time until bed. So break it down. And if you can kind of keep driving your thoughts and pulling them back to those manageable chunks of time, it can help you to slowly walk through time when you're feeling overwhelmed or feeling a lot of stress. A recent strategy that I've been talking a lot, certainly as we've kind of been managing the pandemic this year, I've used this before, but this has been really helpful this year with all of the uncertainty, is sorting your thoughts into this concept of sorting your thoughts into past, present, and future. So can you, in this process of checking in with yourself, say, "Ooh, that is a future thought. I'm going to save that for the efficacy of my future self." So I don't know where I'm going to be by the summer, but I will let my summer self deal with that. I don't know. I have a client right now who is a bit worried. She's got a child and it's working right now with school that they're doing this, and she's working from home and managing treatment, and it's somewhat working right now, but she's really beginning to feel overwhelmed and anxious about the summer. Like, what am I gonna do when the school year is over and he's gonna be here? And I get that. And I think there's validity in being aware and kind of tuned into what's coming down the road. And I tell her that. I said, I think there's great value in the fact that you're identifying this anxiety for yourself. And what are the things you can have control over and what you can do right now? Is there anything? And if not, then where do we need to put this into the future? Where do we need to bookmark this so that we can leave it to that self who might have more control and might know more? So maybe it might be your March self, right? When camps begin to open and begin to kind of figure it out. Or maybe it's your May self. At what point do you say, okay, this is a big deal. Thinking about it right now is not serving me because there's nothing I can do about it. And it's just leaving me feeling fluttered. And so but I don't want to forget about it. So I'm going to bookmark this thought. I'm going to reserve it for my future self. I do that a lot too when people are worried and concerned about whether or not they should take medicine. Should I be taking an antidepressant? Should I be taking an anti-anxiety medicine? And as a therapist, I'll say, what I'm going to do is I am going to circle this day on my calendar, and I'm going to say, we're talking about this. And I'm going to say, well, you're telling me you're experiencing, and I'm going to bookmark it. That means I'm not going to jump right now out of this, but I'm going to say, hey, we're going to mark this and we're going to check. And then I'm going to put a note here to check in on this in a couple of weeks and to see where you are. So we're going to let that fight with should I or should I not go. We're going to let that go. We're not going to forget about it, but we're going to bookmark it for our future self, right? So that's kind of letting yourself kind of be released from some things that might be more future oriented. Give yourself permission to delegate future to that point. So give yourself permission to delegate future-oriented thoughts to your future self. Okay. A strategy. Strategy 4, control, alt, delete. Oh man, I love this one. I really love this. And I'm going to share it. I hope you love it as much as I do. Sometimes when things just feel so too much, we got to control, alt, delete our way out of this. So you know what I mean by control, alt, delete on your computer, when your computer freezes and it gets all what my kids call glitchy. So you got to control, alt, delete and get it to kind of break up. Sometimes it's really, really helpful to parachute outside of our worry. Get outside. If you're sitting inside and it's consuming you and you're feeling just suffocated by everything, just the simple act of walking outside into the day and the change of air and the sky, that'll likely change it for you. Just watch. A creative project, is there the opportunity? And sometimes I realize there's not, but is there the opportunity to, I'm going to put this down right now because I can't focus anymore on this. There's nothing else for me to do. Or I'm recognized that I'm kind of lost in this emotion about this. I'm going to put it down and I'm just going to go cook. I'm going to go. People talk to me about those things that you do that are somewhat have a meditative quality. Cooking may not be it for you. I get that. It's not for many, but some people say, you know, yeah, chopping carrots, that really kind of is calming to me, or cooking. Some people talk to me about gardening. It's the dead of the winter. We can't garden, but our building something, our writing, our music, our, you know, playing an instrument, our, you know, lighting candles in their room, something that helps them to kind of parachute out of this moment. Physical activity will most generally always do it. You know, I've certainly said to in my home, when we're all kind of at each other and it's too much right now, or in life when it's too much, or I'm at work and things just feel overwhelming and I've got so many things of piles on my desk, I need to get out and I get to do a quick walk either around the office or around outside, come back, and somehow it all just looks a little different when we move our bodies and we get ourselves moving. Connect with others. A quick phone call or a quick text to people just helps you to kind of parachute out of that for a bit. Reading, humor. Oh my goodness, humor. Humor is such a help, such a piece of resilience in the midst of hard times. You could probably add to this list. This is a few things, but I would challenge you to keep figuring out what are ways that you can kind of anchor outside of your worry. Thought delay is that concept I was just kind of talking about before, giving yourself permission to put this significant worry, what is important to you, to a future time. That's not dismissing it. I'm not saying you're dismissing, avoiding, or ignoring it. I'm saying that you've come to realize there's nothing you can realistically do within your own control about this right now, but it does matter to you and you don't want to let it go. So you're going to delay it. That's thought delay. Mock the feeling kind of takes some air out of things. So when you're feeling something, if you just kind of either sing song voice it or kind of talk back at it or call it, you know, it sounds silly, but it can really take the steam out of a feeling. Face the bully in your mind. So, okay, I see you. I see you worry and fear. I hear you coming at me today. What do you got for me? Like, I got this. It kind of sets you up. So that's the idea of facing the bully in your mind. And if there's questions, we can talk more about that at the end. Oop, I went quick again. Hold on. Let's go backwards. I skipped a slide. Okay. So taking back control. This is a pretty fundamental basic slide, though I think it's super important to have in here because we forget about the places where we have control. And some of those are just very, you know, biological. You know, you have control over what time you go to bed at night, you know, getting regular and consistent sleep. And if you're not sleeping well, something to talk about and to kind of think about a little bit differently. What might be contributing to sleep? I talk to a lot of people that are struggling with sleep and how they can kind of think about that time or that in a different way. Nourished, you know, don't we feel different when we're tired and hungry and dehydrated? We do. And all of those things are things that we do have some degree of control over. So I know for myself, I'm a little blurry eyed and kind of disconnected when I'm not have forgotten to drink water all day, or if I'm sitting at my desk and I've forgotten to get up and go have my lunch, right? So those are things that you absolutely have control. When we think about caring for yourself, these things help you to feel different or to face your day in a different way. Certainly feeling connected and acknowledged, those are also things that help us to feel more confident, more grounded, more capable. And on the conversely, when we're tired, when we're not sleeping, when you're hungry and you're not eating well, you know, rushing out the door and not eating in the morning or not stopping to eat through the day, or you're sick or you're overwhelmed or emotional, those things make it harder to cope. And so some of those things we have control over, some of those things we may not. I am very acutely aware that I'm talking to a group of people who are likely managing many different side effects and things. And so when you're feeling that stress, instead of kind of beginning to kind of compound that with, and also I can't do this or I'm not doing this well, can you have a moment of self-compassion of, gosh, you know what? I don't really feel that great. I'm dealing with these side effects. No wonder I feel lower tolerance for people, or I have less patience. You know, I've got to accept that for myself. I've got to know that for me so that I can be gentler with myself walking into the day too, and lower those expectations, maybe even that I'm setting for myself. So Self-awareness, taking back control. Where are your triggers? Do you know what those are? I just put three pictures here of triggers that I hear very common in my office, that certain people can be triggers for people. Dates on the calendar, and not just dates on the calendar, but sometimes the time of the year, the season can be a trigger. And then there's hot topics. Everybody has different hot topics. Politics can be a hot topic. The way in which you're caring for yourself, the way in which you're communicating with the children, what you're eating or how you're exercising, all of those things can be hot topics and are something just to know, ooh, when this enters into the field of conversation, I need to back down. I need to put my shoulders down. I may need to back out because this gets me going. Speaking of that, navigating awkward conversations, I have this quick slide in here because this conversation, this comes up a lot in my sessions with people. How do I navigate conversations in the workplace that are tricky? People that I don't really, are times when I just don't feel like talking about my cancer diagnosis, or I just don't want to spend all of my time at work updating people, even if they have well-meaning, I just don't want to deal with that, are people who do say pretty awkward and shocking things to me. What do I do with that? So I think in my head, can you frame that in stop, shift, and stabilize? So first things first, you got to stop the conversation. You don't want to get in the midst of what feels like an awkward conversation and then to have to keep rolling with it or keep going with it. So you can rehearse and come up with just very simple ways of responding to people that lets them know that you're not planning to talk about it right now, that feel comfortable for you. So things I've written down here, you know, usually I am fine talking about my diagnosis, but today I just want to focus on different things. Tell me more about, so the kind of the, I want to focus on something different. Or you can use humor. Oh goodness, I am so sick of talking about my stupid cancer. Let's talk about something more interesting. Yeah, please. Oh my goodness. It's same old, same old. You know, all of those things are you not minimizing yourself? You still know that this is important to you. It's really more sending a message of this isn't the time or the space that I want to do this right now. Now, you have to move on to shift because unfortunately, when you make a statement like that that stops the conversation, all eyes are still on you. Spotlight is still shining straight in your eyes, right? Like people are like, oh, no problem. You know, you don't want to make them feel awkward, but you are probably still in the person that needs to keep move the conversation moving. So then we have to shift the direction. So you've got to also be prepared to kind of pass the baton. So, you know, usually I'm fine talking about my diagnosis, but you know what? I don't have it in me today. So tell me, weren't you planning a vacation? Tell me more about your vacation. Or, oh my gosh, I'm so sick and tired of talking about cancer. Let's talk about something more interesting. Is your son going to be able to do the Little League this year? Or what are we going to do about that? Meeting later today? How you begin to shift it so that everybody knows, oh, I got it. Now I know what we're supposed to talk about here. Good. You know, everybody's clear. And then when that happens and the focus is off of you or you've maneuvered that conversation, you might still be feeling some degree of unsettledness from having to do that heavy lifting, having to do that work. And so take it upon yourself to check in quietly in your mind and to quiet yourself, you know, breathe, get your feet on the ground, pay attention to what somebody else is saying so that you're kind of, again, parachuting outside of that. You know, that's an important step in this, is that not only do you stop a conversation that you don't really want to have in a workplace in a tactful but clear way, you shifted it so that people know where to go next, but then you get calm and you feel grounded. Ways to be zen at work. I found this once in a magazine. I loved this idea. So I thought I would pop it in here and show you. Do someone a favor. So ways that you can kind of just bring a different energy to your work day. Do someone a favor. That also, sometimes when our worry and our fear is present, it is all about the I feel this, I feel this. And so when we do something for somebody else, it kind of helps us to turn the spotlight off of ourselves too, which can help to kind of slow down or dissipate some of that stress. Let yourself procrastinate. Now, this might sound controversial, and I'm not saying don't do your job, but sometimes we need just a breath or some space in our day. So give yourself permission to have that space. get your stuff done. But still, no, you know what? It's counterintuitive that when we feel pressure, we feel like we need to work harder, longer, faster. And sometimes what we really need is to step away and get some balance and get some clarity so that we can face that with a new perspective and a little bit more refreshed. Hide your phone. I mean, our phones can be really tricky and really hard for us. So put it away, turn it upside down, turn off the ringer, hide your phone. Disappear for a bit. Go where nobody can find you. You know, whether that's at work, whether that's at home, I have lots of parents that I work with that kind of need to disappear a little bit from kids, whether it's in a bathroom, they just need some space and some time. Just disappear a little bit, gather yourself, give yourself that moment. End your day like you mean it. This is my favorite one on the entire slide. Don't just come home, eat dinner, go to bed, repeat, wash and repeat, you know, Groundhog Day, we're Groundhog Day. Give yourself the end of the day. End it like you mean it. Put on those cozy clothes, sit in your chair, especially for all of us who are working at home. How can you distinguish the end of the day and really end it in a way that feels really nice and rewarding for you? There's research, this one here about a break. There's research that says that people are more productive and get more done, more productive and manage their day in a better way if they take a break before lunch. Because I think sometimes we grind and we push through and then we take our break around 2 or 3 in the afternoon when we are depleted. But for those that take a break before lunch, it's kind of like giving yourself a snack all day long, right? So that you kind of keep your energy and your attention going and your focus. Gossip with a coworker. I don't mean to be catty and gossipy. That basically is connect. Connect with other people. And that means that that certainly has a great value right now when many of us are working from home or not as connected. How do you find those ways to connect? It gives you perspective and balance. Speaking of perspective, our perspective works two ways. And so you can use this as a skill too. As you're listening closely to yourself, there may be times when it feels so hard and difficult that you need to zoom way out to the big picture, your big arc of your life, and help you to realign and to kind of get connected to the values and the intentions that are your North Star. Who am I? What am I always been proud about for myself? What do I hope for myself? What do I dream for myself? Who am I? What have people always told me about me, and how do I apply that to my right now? That's that zoom out. And then other times, it feels so confusing and overwhelming. You got to zoom way on in to this day, this moment, this task. Okay, so allowing for that ability and that flexibility to go back and forth with your perspective. So that is all I have for us. I believe that is my last slide. So Nicole, I'm going to share the mic with you now, I think, and let me know if there are questions that have come up that we can kind of dive into in a little bit more deeper way.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Julie. It really is such a challenge to cover this topic in only an hour, but I do hope that this presentation gave you all some tools that you can use to really stay in control of work in your life. Before we move on to the Q&A portion, I just want to point out that we do have a number of free events coming up this year. These are a few of our upcoming Balancing Work and Cancer webinars. Registration for all remaining sessions can be found on the Balancing Work and Cancer webinar series event page. I do also want to point out we have our virtual Midwest conference taking place on Friday, March 26th. And our national conference will also be virtual this year, as everything seems to be now. And that's going to be taking place on June 26th. So registration is currently open for both. And I definitely encourage you all to attend if you're interested. You can always also check out cancerandcareers.org for more information. Okay. And I just want to leave up the CEU requirements now, and we will head into the Q&A. So just as we mentioned, if you have questions, you can put them into the Q&A box. If you're on the phone and you have a question, you can press *9 and we will see that you have raised your hand. So we do have some questions in the chat box, Julie, if you're ready to go.
I'm looking at that chat box too. So I'll listen to what you got and I'll watch too.
Okay, great. So we have one from, forgive me if I mispronounce your name, Mary-Eve. She asked, what if small talk is the hardest conversation for you? My boss won't stop talking about herself and her kids, and I don't want to offend her, but it drains my energy and I can't focus on work.
Yeah, so you're needing to redirect the conversation, but it's not necessarily in a way that's feeling intrusive about your own cancer diagnosis or you. It's just needing to kind of limit and draw boundaries with your boss. I also just want to take a moment to acknowledge that you're talking about your boss. So there's also that hierarchy and that difference in kind of power and control, power and status there too, that makes sometimes those setting boundaries a little bit more difficult. But what you're really talking about is boundaries. How do you set boundaries? How do you make that very clear? And what I would recommend is just, you know, kind of returning back to your workday. Since this is your boss, since this is somebody that you work for, can you say, you know what, can you end that conversation? Love hearing about this. And you know what? I would love to talk longer, but I am feeling like I need to get to these emails or this work that you need me to get done. I need to go do that right now, but maybe we can chat later. Pushing it off later to another time. Just sometimes steering clear, like, so moving into a different way, giving yourself a permission to not have to always be present and be available, you know, so being able to say, I don't have time to chat right now. I need to go work on this, but can we talk more later? Putting it off, those things might be helpful.
Definitely never an easy conversation to have. We have another question from Jill. Can you speak a bit more about any tips for transitioning those what if thoughts regarding a recurrence?
Can I speak a bit more about transitioning the what if thoughts? So I guess part of me is wondering what specifically is working or not working for you. So if we can go back, if we could go back to the slide about what turning what if into what is. So when I say that, you know, a lot of people have worry about what if the cancer comes back, or what if my scan shows something that I don't want it to show, right? What if? And first of all, those feelings understandably and normally get more intense and stronger as you get closer to a scan. So that might be something that you begin to recognize in your own self-awareness. Like if this scan is on, like, you know, the first of the month, then, you know, start watching, okay, by about 3 weeks out, I begin to start to feel that anxiety and it gets more intense. And then the follow-up visit happens and I feel lighter. Ooh, but then surprisingly or not surprisingly over time, that feeling begins to build and get more intense as I get closer and closer to the scan. That's normal. That's understandable. But begin to watch what that timeline is for you so that you can be gentle with yourself and know, okay, this is, I can learn to expect this for myself. Secondly, how do you go back to the black and white information that you have, the hard facts? So my last scan was 3 months ago. And in that scan, there was no evidence of disease, no evidence of progression. In addition to that, I continue to feel, I'm feeling more and more energy. My hair is continuing to grow back. You know, I'm recognizing that I'm eating in different ways than I used to. So can you take a comparison between yourself now and yourself 3 months ago or yourself 6 months ago? Sometimes when we're looking just at our day to day, what isn't working is so loud, right? It's the loudest thing in the room. But when we look back and we're like, gosh, if I really think about it, 3 months ago, I wasn't able to do this. And my hair has grown so much since that time. That's evidence too, that your body is healing. So finding those things can help to ground you and get you to that scan where you learn more concrete information. I hope that's helpful. Mostly, I want you to know that fear of recurrence and the way that those what ifs begin to get heavier is so normal. And hopefully as you get more and more time under your belt, you'll begin to kind of both recognize that normalcy and learn how to be tender and gentle with yourself through it.
That's a great answer. Thank you, Julie. I think we have time for one more question. I know we are at 12 o'clock on the dot, but hoping to just squeeze one more in. This one is, how do I best answer the question, how are you doing? I want to tell them I have cancer. How do you think I'm doing? But I know that isn't the best response.
Well, I think that's a really great question. And wow, wish we had all the time in the world to answer that. Your answer to that question, first and foremost, your answer to that question is likely going to be different based on who's asking it, right? There are some people who you're going to be really vulnerable and honest with. You know what? It's not been easy. It's been really hard. And I find that there are times I'm doing much better, and then there are times when I'm not. You're more honest, you're more authentic, you're more genuine with those people in our inner circle who we have learned over time we can trust will respond to us in just the right way, right? But if you don't know that about your audience, if you don't necessarily know or trust that they're going to be able to take the depth or the intimacy of your answer, then you might have a different answer. You might say, you know what? It's been a tricky year. It's been challenging. And these things have been really helpful. And these things have been really hard. And you make it more concrete and practical and tangible. And then there are other people who absolutely will not handle that at all. They will give an awkward and maybe even dismissive or a response that feels hurtful or disappointing to you. And that might be something to think about. And so for those people, you may not go there, because to go there and to say anything about how you're really feeling or what's really going on for you could be responded to in such a flippant or cavalier way that would further hurt you. So by protecting yourself and saying, oh gosh, you know, the year's been hard for everybody and we just are doing this, by not necessarily disclosing to those people, protects you from feeling disappointed and further hurt. Does that make sense? So it's really the way in which you answer is so dependent upon who's asking you and what you know about that relationship in your life.
Absolutely. And I just want to jump in and just point out that we have information on a verbal technique we call the swivel. And that's to help you kind of handle some of these comments in the workplace that you're not totally sure how to handle. Maybe you don't want to share information about yourself, but you're kind of put on the spot. This really can help you kind of navigate those conversations in a way where you regain control over the conversation and what you want to share with them.
Disclosure is a really big topic in the workplace, and people don't know how to handle it. It's very, very complex. And Cancer and Career has amazing resources around disclosure and how to handle that with many different types of work relationships.
Absolutely. And we have some webinars coming up that will be covering that as well. So definitely check those out if you're interested in that. Just in the to respect everyone's time, it is 2 after the hour, so I am going to conclude this webinar now. I really hope that you enjoyed it. I know that it was very valuable information, so we really greatly appreciate your feedback if you wouldn't mind sharing it with us. As I mentioned, we'll be circulating our online evaluation form, and we really would appreciate if you could take the time to fill it out so we can best continue to develop this program to meet your needs. If there were any questions that we didn't get to during the call today, please feel free to email them to us at cancerandcareers@cew.org, and we'll be sure to get answers for you to those questions. I do want to just thank you again, Julie, for your insights and taking the time to share with us all today. And thank you all for attending. Have a wonderful rest of your day.
Absolutely. Take care. Thank you.